topics relating to or public benefit and more broadly the definition of charity in New Zealand law. The first panel, this panel is going to put the question of social housing, which of course has been a contested issue in New Zealand, and then they'll be followed by a panel looking at charity advocacy, which should be interesting. So, without further ado, I'm going to invite Andrew Butler, Scott Figenshow, and Peter Gunn to each say something for about 10 minutes relating to this question of social housing and how it comes to different circuits.
Good afternoon, everyone. Now, the first opportunity is for some disclosure. I'm not a lawyer, but thank you for that. I'm not sure that might have been an offer of a promotion, but I'm not sure. You can tell me that it doesn't have a tie on. Look, what I want to talk about as the slides come up here is some particular cases that we experienced in the community housing sector. I want to talk a little bit about the Queenstown West case that Andrew spoke about. I'll speed this up for a second. This is a little bit of background on who we are as a peak body and the nature of the work that we do, really supporting and advocating for community housing providers and their ability to provide a whole lot more social and affordable housing. So I wanted to just ponder a minute the difference between social housing and affordable housing, because that's part of where the points that Andrew made, we start to become unstuck. So there's never been concern about providing social housing, and that's arguably been the purview of what the state has done through Housing New Zealand. And just to give you a little history, it was back in the late 1990s, early 2000s, when not-for-profit providers started to become, it was desirable under government policy to actually have multiple players in the marketplace using some of the current language, correct? And so it was the attempt to start setting up not-for-profit providers who would be providing initially rental housing for around 70-80% of market rent for people who were not eligible for state housing. So there was some recognition about the need for a systems approach here. Now, so where did the systems approach take us? One of the things New Zealand has done over the last several years, and I think we need to commend our multiple successive governments for this, and commend ourselves, is we've been moving down the road of adopting a human rights-based approach to housing. We've signed up to the United Nations protocols, and a lot of the work we've been spending has been around trying to understand what that would mean in practice. So, here, a moment of shameless promotion, there really hasn't been a government housing strategy or housing plan, so community housing sector said, we'll put our hands up with our other NGO partners, and we'll start putting one together. It's called Our Place. The vision is all New Zealanders well housed. It is not some New Zealanders well housed. It means everybody. And it's based on the UN housing adequacy definition. So that's another word I'd like to put us up in lights here when we're thinking about charitable purpose. So the United Nations defines housing adequacy. There's seven metrics, but the five most relevant for us here in New Zealand are habitability, affordability, security of tenure, accessibility, and cultural adequacy. So the primary thing I'm asking us to think about is if we achieve all of those measures, does it satisfy the public benefit test? So what we think this means in practical terms is it does mean those positive outcomes for communities, families, and individuals. So again, a connection back to seeing that the Local Government Act is being amended to put the well-beings back into their purpose. We think that's a positive step. The local responses to delivery, again, shouldn't local communities be defining about what need is and how they need it? And then the third thing is this long-term certainty of the operating environment, and you're going to hear me say about that in a minute. So New Zealand actually used to have a fantastic housing system. If we do harken back to some time many, many decades ago, New Zealand led the world in how it created a housing system that produced a lot of houses that were genuinely affordable to our working class and to folks who found themselves in trouble or under housing stress from whatever reason. So I just put across the bottom here. So on the emergency housing and social housing aspect of this, yeah, those things are both shared. We're pretty comfortable about that now. Although, hang on, housing New Zealand pays tax. How do you work that one out? Moving on. The assisted rental and assisted ownership space, it's both a tick mark and a question mark. So the assisted rental is that providing a rent that might be 60-70% of the rent in an area. That's not what makes it charitable. It's that those people that are being served have largely been accepted to meet that public kind of test. It is in the assisted ownership space where things have come unstuck. And as we move into private rental and private ownership, again, there's no expectation that those things are inherently shareable. So, again, if we make these five measures for being well-housed, using our United Nations right to housing approach, you're going to meet the public benefit test. So I'm going to pick on affordable for a moment, because that's another area that there's a lot of debate going on. We are very clear. Affordable means you're spending not more than a third or the 30% of your household income on your rent or mortgage repayments. Okay? Affordable, and this is an opportunity we have to engage with our current government about the QE bill discussion. It's trying to talk about affordable housing. Quite frankly, we don't think that a house at a price of $600,000 is in and of itself an affordable house. So what we've been trying to suggest is that some of the tools around shared ownership and shared equity are some of those vehicles where you could actually make sure that a $600,000 house is genuinely affordable to a family who is earning a median income, might be $70,000 a year. They could probably afford between $300,000 to $400,000 in their rent or mortgage, plus their savings using their key savings. So there is a way to make a $600,000 house affordable. But we think it's also around habitability, the security of tenure. Security of tenure has to be met both, can be both met through secure tenure rental, as well as through the pathways to home ownership. And we've also learned from a lot of our EWE and Maori housing providers that security of tenure means ownership. It does not mean secure tenure rental. And if we're going to be culturally appropriate in our responses, we have to allow ownership to be something that is a legitimate pathway forward. So I'm just going to give you a little, summary here so that the Queenstown Lakes Community Housing Trust case, this is a bit of the time frame history. And if I had the time to do the graphic, what I would stamp across this is $500,000. That's the amount of money that has been spent. That's a house. We wasted a house over from 2009 to 2016 on the effort and process it took to get to where we are. That's not all. That is the most expensive way to do policy that I've never come up with. And we still don't actually have the kind of policy environment that we really need. So just quickly here. So this is actually quite personal because I worked through a lot of these pieces in this case from the trust and the local authority side at that time. So there was a notification of deregistration. Mind you, that the trust was only set up in 2007. There was a year spent deliberating with then the Charities Commission. There was a high court case. The trust lost. There was an assessment of $6.1 million in tax on a $10 million asset at that time. That asset came through a quite innovative way that the local authority was bringing in private development contributions for delivering affordable housing. We had all these tests around affordability. The Crown decided, actually, that isn't right. That is not consistent with our other housing policy. So the Crown agreed to pay that tax bill and make it go away, which was the right decision. There's been a subsequent set of advice on how the trust could reestablish its tax status. That led to a review of the entire community housing sector to understand whether organizations might be at risk, which led to new legislation being set up that provided for a community housing entity form of tax exemption. It's not charitable status. It is a parallel form of exemption. So the point that I make with that is that rather than actually fix the main system, we've done a parallel system. Is that the kind of outcome we want for long-term policy settings? And then most recently, the trust applied again and was again rejected for charitable status. So at this point, we have one of our largest, most sophisticated providers is still outside the charitable tent. although they do have tax exempt status, and there's still questions around whether that in fact meets the question around trust, Andy, that you brought up, whether that is that the proper tax status to meet the trust requirements. So as community housing entity option, these are the tests that are now in the legislation, and to be honest, they're good. I still worry about when a piece of legislation identifies exact dollar amounts, there is no provision for inflation, there's no clear and simple means for this becoming adjusted automatically over time. That's a concern. And yeah, for instance, Tom will be detecting that. So there are some pros to this. It is reasonably easy to comply. Okay, that's probably one of the big ones. However, not many organizations are using this because it isn't as good as charitable status programs. And there's uncertain monitoring. What providers are wanting is that they can send a list through every year. These are the household by assisted, these are their incomes, and you get something back that says, yes, you are fully compliant with all those requirements. So you stop this worry about retrospective risk if you have a situation where somebody questions something in the future. And quite frankly, the biggest worry is that third point there around this legislation, of course, is open to amendment by any government at any point in time, and which violates that key principle. If we're going to have a rights-based, deliver on a rights-based housing approach, we need to have long-term certainty in the operating environment. So we made that submission to the bills that went through in 2015. And so this is the last one here, and what I'll leave you with is the slide, the lower part of the slide is the Waimakia Inlet development in South Auckland. It is the single highest producing special housing area in Auckland. It is delivering 280 brand new mixed tenure homes on what was a piece of governmental land. It is one third social housing, helping with rent assistance to the income-related necessity. It is one-third shared ownership housing, where families are buying roughly 60-70% of the house, and the trust, in this case, the Montefiore, together with the Zealand Housing Foundation, own that other share. Okay? And then the other third is open market sales, that whatever the market price may be. So that's the picture of the mixed-tenure, mixed-income communities that we want, that we need, that we know how to deliver on. How is our environment? The mix of our legal structures, our tax environment, our funding environment, our housing policy environment, how are those going to align so that we're doing 15 Waimakia Inlets all at the same time all around the country? The piece on the little picture on the upper side is we did our annual meeting in December up in Tallaght. We've got an amazing delivery of Papatania housing, and an amazing delivery also by the Portuguese of a new development of a multiple on Maori land that they might be across as a freehold, and want to use shared ownership, again, as the way to give their tribal members ownership back into the community at a price they can afford. So this works in a lot of ways, but we need to get all the pieces to line up. So what settings will foster a scale response? Social
and affordable housing.
And I'll leave it there. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Scott. Peter, would you like to comment?
Sure, Tato. I'm here as the fair guy on the panel, I think. I stand here as a bureaucrat, as a lawyer, and as the person who appeared for the Commission on Queenstown Lakes case, so three strikes and I'm out before I even begin. One of the points that I need to make at the outset is that I'm here to present, obviously, my perspective rather than a perspective from the Commission's point of view, whether they're at the Department of Internal Affairs or indeed from the Crown Law Office where I work. But having said that, my perspective is that there is nothing much wrong with the law in this particular area, as you might expect it to say. And it struck me, actually, listening to both Scott and Andrew, that There is perhaps some measure of agreement between the three of us, not complete agreement, obviously, but some measure of agreement on the point. And I would like to just perhaps draw out one or two of the aspects of the Queenstown Lakes case that haven't been focused on by other Scott or Andrew that may help you to understand why I take that view. The first point that may be made is that Queenstown is relatively recent, it's 2011, but in my view, and it's still good law, and that's notwithstanding the fact that we've had some important changes to the law of charities in New Zealand since then, notably with the Supreme Court's decision of Greenpeace. But essentially, the Queenstown case still represents the law in the community housing theory. Facts of Queenstown have been dealt with by Andrew, and I won't traverse them at any length. He talked about the objects of the trust and put the overhead up for you on that front. One of the aspects of the trust related to the criteria, though, that were applicable to people seeking to gain assistance from the trust. And this is a very important point from the court's perspective as to which people qualify for assistance from the trust. And the trustee, or at least the criteria, provided that before you could get assistance from the trust, your combined household income must not exceed $86,000 if you were a single individual, or $122,000 for a four-person household. And bear in mind that these are 2009 figures that we were talking about. And when the trust came to court seeking to defend its position as a charity on relief of poverty grounds, the person who was assisting me in Crown Office at that time, who was earning rather less than half of the $86,000 that provided the minimum criteria for assistance, was outraged that poverty grounds even being advanced. But personal reflections aside, the court was taken by those income levels and did think they were significant. The other eligibility criteria, which reflects some of the community interest points that have been touched on by both Andrew and Scott, were that in order to qualify for assistance, you had to be a New Zealand resident, and you had to be at least have one member of your household employed full-time in Queenstown. And that reflected the sort of values that the trust was trying to promote by helping people who earned less than the Queenstown mean from being able to buy a house or rent a house in the Queenstown area. But the trust was originally registered by the Charities Commission and then subsequently deregistered on review on the basis that it didn't meet the criteria for registration. I appeared, as I said, in the High Court in the case, and by way of side, I say that when we do appear for the Commission in such cases, we appear as counsel assisting the court. We're not there to argue for the Commission itself. It's appropriate for the Commission as decision maker to stand by and rely on its decision rather than attempt to relitigate such matters in court. I know that's something that Sue Barker has had some issues with in the past. But that was the basis on which we appeared, and we did so appear. Now, it's also important, I think, to make clear that the Commission had no argument with the proposition that lower income earners in Queenstown face difficulties in renting or owning homes in Queenstown, given the cost of housing in Queenstown. Nor was there any dispute that there was potential community benefit from the trust. The essence of the Commission's decision was that the trust was not a charitable trust having regard to normal principles of charities law. Now, Andrew's talked about the two arguments that were raised. The first argument was the fact that the trust was charitable because it was for the relief of poverty. I already touched on that. But the court said no, poverty could be a relative concept. You might be poor in one district and not so poor in another, but you still had to have in mind that you couldn't extend the concept of relative poverty to indefinite limits. And the court was not prepared to accept that $86,000 or $122,000 was poverty in a particular context. One of the other important aspects, though, in coming to that conclusion, which bears on what Scott's talked about, though, is that the court also had regard to whether housing was a human right and was influenced in coming to the conclusion that this was not a charity because of the fact that found that housing was available in other local areas, and they talked about Cromwell and Kingston, I think, as being possible areas that people in Queenstown could purchase housing in. Turning to the community benefit, the arguments against that particular proposition, including the state of the Queenstown roads in winter and the like, but that was a matter that the court heard some evidence on and decided in the way that it did. However, turning to the real basis on which the decision was made, the court concluded that while the recipients of the benefits from the trust might contribute to the social, cultural, or economic development of Queenstown, the trust didn't confer on the community, and looking at the public benefit side of the equation, didn't confer on the community such a sufficiently tangible and clearly defined public benefit as to bring the trust purposes within the fourth head of charity. So, turning back to my initial question, what is broken about the decision? In my view, nothing, or at least not very much. As the court noted in its decision, the commission accepted that providing housing to the poor is charitable, and assisting the poor to buy housing through shared ownership or other direct financial aid can also be charitable, as the charities register currently demonstrates. I suggest that Queenstown turns on its own facts, and in particular, the special character of Queenstown and the eligibility criteria that apply to those gaining benefits under the trust. I also suggest that it's quite possible that if there were to be another housing case arising in a different area, perhaps with a deed that might be drafted somewhat differently, the court could easily reach a different result. But I suspect that no such case and no such appeal will ever be filed. And I say that because I think that if such a case did arise, I suspect the court or the board wouldn't consider that the grounds existed that existed in the Queenstown case to refuse registration or to deregister any entity. I only know this at second hand, but my understanding is that the decision in Queenstown hasn't led to any significant changes in the charities register, and that most large housing providers, even when they are providing home ownership schemes, do so with a focus on public benefit, on the relief of poverty and or assistance to the aged, or improving the economically deprived regions of the country that poses no issues as to their charitable status. As anyone who has holidayed in Queenstown recently will confirm, Queenstown is not an economically deprived region. Perhaps the other way in which the decision may have been thought to have been productive of the broken outcome if the trust was unable to receive taxation relief or the perceived public benefits that was delivered. But as Scott has mentioned, that has not been the case. Following the decision, government moved to amend tax laws so that the trust is essentially in an equivalent taxation position to that it would have been and had it been held to have been a charity. I suggest that as a matter of law, that outcome is entirely appropriate. changes to the tax law reflect Parliament's acceptance that the trust is delivering a public benefit which merits tax relief. However, that change has been achieved without straining, straining to my word, the definition of what is charitable. Scott made a point that there are disadvantages in the solution that's been arrived at, which is that governments can change the law, but for the benefit of you non-lawyers out there, governments can change the law in any particular direction, not just in tax, but also in charities law as well. So there is no solution to the game in that respect. I'm conscious that not everyone has the ability or the funds to put a case to the government for changes to the tax law, but my point remains that charities that do fit within established definitions will have no, should have no difficulty in gaining or maintaining registration and thereby achieving consequential tax relief. I do acknowledge that there may be something of a potential chilling effect of the Queenstown decision on those seeking to deliver public benefit, and I don't hide from that possibility. But I do suggest that there is a need to consider and balance not only that public benefit, but also the wider question of maintaining public trust and confidence in registered charitable entities. The Commission, in making its decision, decided that removal of the trust from the charities register was necessary for public trust and confidence in the sector which we maintain. It seems to me that that's an entirely reasonable conclusion. Would an ordinary member of the public, or at least one living outside central Otago, agree that an entity designed to help Queenstown residents buy a home in the Queenstown area should be regarded as a charity? Andrew's done the poll, and some of you would, but some of you wouldn't. And I suggest that a significant number of people wouldn't, and that Queenstown Trust's continued registration as a charitable entity would indeed raise questions of public trust and confidence in the charitable sector. Thank you very much.